Good Sunday morning, and welcome to the February 13th, 2022 edition of the Pastor Porch. I'm Pastor Brian Schmidt, pastor of Calvary Alliance Church in beautiful Hiawassee, Georgia. Just an incredibly beautiful day today. I'm actually videoing this on Thursday, and it's just a glorious day today. But I'm actually not even in Hiawassee. I'm actually out on a field trip. I'm actually in Athens, Georgia, and this is not the Pastor's Porch. It's not the pastor's basement. It's not the pastor's church. It's the pastor's bus for a period of time until I pick students back up from the University of Georgia, Athens, go Bulldogs, and take them back up to Towns County. But I have to use my time wisely, and so this is an opportunity I have to do the video and use this time that's given to me. So anyway, here I am, the pastor's bus, and for the sermon for February 13th, 2022. Hey, I want to start by talking today about opposites. And you know what opposites are, all right? So if I say hot, you say, yeah, you say cold. If I say light, you say dark. If I say old, you say new. I had some other thoughts that came to mind, but that's okay. And then opposites, all right? So today's message from Romans gives another example of opposites, if you will. And it's not things, but it's actually people. Now, I've entitled this message, Two Guys, because I couldn't help but think of that delicious burger chain called Five Guys. And maybe I'll even be able to find one around here and get lunch before we head back to Towns County. But seriously, though, Paul is going to contrast in this passage of scripture for today, two different men. He's going to contrast the choices they made, the consequence of those choices, and then the conclusion of those consequences, the bottom line, the end result. And these two guys that we're going to find in our passage today are Adam, first of all, the first man formed by God's hand from the dust of the earth. God breathed into him the breath of life, and man became a living soul. And man, humanity, humans are entirely different from any other created thing that God has made. But Adam was formed by God on the sixth day of creation, and the Lord placed him in the Garden of Eden with his wife to come, Eve. And there they had a perfect environment. All right, just imagine, they had the perfect environment there in the Garden of Eden. They didn't have to worry about bugs. They didn't have to worry about weeds. They didn't have to worry about global warming or anything like that. It was perfect. And they had the perfect relationship with one another. Adam and Eve, they didn't have any quarrels. They didn't fight, disagreements. They didn't debate about where they were going to eat. It was perfect for them, perfect relationship. And then they had a perfect relationship with God. They walked with God in the garden, and there was no sin. There was nothing between them, nothing to hinder their relationship with their creator God. And wow, what an incredible thing. So we're going to talk about Adam. And then secondly, we're going to talk about Jesus. Jesus, the Son of God, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born to the Virgin Mary a little over 2,000 years ago. And Jesus, who died on the cross and then rose again and is in heaven right now, seated at the right hand of God. So we're going to contrast these two men. We're going to read through our text, which I have here on my little sheet of paper. And then we're going to go back and make some contrast between these two gentlemen. All right. Romans chapter 5, verses 12 to 21. I'm going to try to read this with minimal commentary, but I probably will have to make a couple little notes here and there. So if you have your Bibles and are following along, Romans chapter 5, verses 12 through 21. Paul says, therefore, just as through one man, and it's interesting how many times that little expression, one man, shows up in this passage, all right? By one man, sin, all right? Sin, missing the mark, coloring outside the lines, not doing what you're supposed to do or doing what you're not supposed to do, which is the case here. One man's sin entered the world and death, all right, death. The Greek word here is pretty interesting. It's thanatos. And if you're a fan of Marvel movies, you know that the evil guy in the Avengers movies, the guy named, what, Thanos, which means death, all right? So that's where we're at here, and death, talking about physical death, spiritual death, all right? And death through sin, and thus death spread to all. And there's another little word that gets repeated quite often here. To all men, because all sinned. For until the law, sin was in the world, but sin was not imputed where there was no law. All right? It's just kind of, he's saying it's kind of hard to hold people accountable to something they don't know exists yet. All right. But does that mean they were excused? No, because when we read Genesis chapter 5 in the genealogy there, it talks about so-and-so begat so-and-so, and then what happened? They died. And that's repeated throughout the passage here in Genesis chapter 5. And so people were still held accountable. It was just, it's kind of hard to do that when you don't have the rules yet. All right. But it says, for unto the law, sin was in the world, but sin was not imputed when there is no law. Verse 14, nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses. That's what we just said in Genesis chapter 5. All right. Even over those who had not sinned according to the likeness of the transgression of Adam, who is a type, a pattern, an example of him who was to come, talking about Jesus. But the free gift is not like the offense. For if by one man's offense many died, men, much more the grace of God and the gift of the grace of one man, Jesus Christ, abounded. All right, this is a word that gets repeated. Abounded, abundance. It means to exceed, to superabound, to overflow. All right, to overflow to many. And the gift from Jesus is not like that which came to the one who sinned, Adam. For the judgment which came from the one offense resulted in condemnation, a guilty sentence. But the free gift which came from many offenses resulted in justification, which means a declaration of innocence. For if by one man's offense death reigned through the one, much more those who receive abundance, overflow of grace, and of the gift of righteousness will reign in life through the one, Jesus Christ. Therefore, we're on verse 18. As through one man's offense judgment came to all men, resulting in condemnation, guilty sentence, even so, through one man's righteous act, the free gift came to all men. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. God so loved what? The world. All right, the gift came to all men, resulting in justification, the declaration of innocence, of life. For as by one man's disobedience, talking about Adam, many were made sinners, so also by one man's obedience, many will be made righteous. And that idea of made there is to put in place, to set down, all right? It means a firm foundation, all right? And that's what we've been talking about in the book of Romans, is foundation, all right? And this continues that theme. Moreover, the law entered, all right? It came alongside, that the offense might abound. It's easy to tell that we're sinners now. But where sin abounded, overflowed, grace abounded, overflowed, much more. So over super abounded. So that as sin reigned in death, even so grace might reign through righteousness to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. What a wonderful passage of scripture we have before us today. But there's a lot of information in these verses. And in fact, one commentator said that the information here is extremely condensed. And the best way I can illustrate this, it comes to mind, is sometimes if I have to download a file, somebody wants to send me something, a document or something, or I'm trying to download something to say from the Christian Missionary Alliance or something like that, something I need, sometimes it gets downloaded as a zip file. And it means they've compressed somehow. I don't understand. It's all technical stuff, and I'm just not into that much anymore. But they compress those files, and they put them in that one file. It's called a zip file. And then when you download it, you can't open it right away. You have to unzip it in order to get the information out that you need. And so what we're going to do today is we're going to kind of unzip this passage by noting three contrasts, all right, opposites between these two men, between Adam and Jesus. The first contrast that we're going to look at are their choices. Their choices. Adam chose to do what? Adam chose to disobey. All right? Disobedience was his choice. Adam's disobedience, his offense, is mentioned in our passage. I'm not going to read each verse again, but verses 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, basically through this whole passage, Romans 15, verses 12 through 21, we see the disobedience of Adam clearly laid out. And Adam's disobedience, if you think about this, was a result of what? It was a result of selfish discontent. Selfish discontent. Adam wasn't contented to eat from all the other trees in the garden. Have you ever thought about this? All right, here's Adam and Eve. They're in the wonderful Garden of Eden, all this wonderful environment, perfect environment in which to live, and all these other wonderful trees that I'm sure were there, all the wonderful fruit trees, all the wonderful vegetables, all the wonderful things that they had at their disposal to munch on. And there was only one tree that God said, don't eat. He said, don't eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And you would think, oh, Adam and Eve, they'd be content with all the other trees and all the other plants and veggies and things. But no, they weren't. It's like, oh, we have all this, but I want that one thing I can't have. And so Adam had to have that one tree that had been forbidden. And that was the cause of his disobedience, that selfish discontent. And this is kind of like an extra, all right? This is just kind of a freebie here. Just be careful of discontent, especially in today's world. You know, we have so much here in America, and you know, even though some shelves are getting a little empty and prices are going up, we are still incredibly blessed. And yet, how many times are we discontented? All right, it's like the new phone comes out. Oh, I gotta have that new phone. You know, the car has a little issue to it. Oh, I gotta have a new car. You know, and the old one's fine. Oh, I gotta have a bigger house. I gotta, you know, and believers, just be careful of discontent. Paul said, contentment is great gain. I'm paraphrasing because it just popped into my head. But contentment, all right, we need to learn to be content. All right, but moving on, Adam, though, he chose to disobey. Even though he had nothing to gain, he thought he did. But even though he had nothing to gain and everything to lose, all right? But what was Jesus' choice? Jesus' choice was obedience. It talks about Jesus' righteous act in verse 18. And then in verse 19, it talks about his obedience. It says, for as by one man's disobedience, talking about Adam, many were made sinners, so also by one man's, Jesus, obedience, many will be made righteous. Jesus was obedient. Whereas Adam's disobedience was a result of selfishness, Jesus' obedience was a result of what? Selflessness. Jesus did not think about himself, but he thought about lost humanity. And as such, he left the glories of heaven to come to this earth to die in our place. That's incredible. Jesus was, he thought about us. He was selfless, even though he had everything to lose and nothing to gain. Mark 10:45 reminds us that even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. Jesus was obedient to the will of the Father. Philippians 2 verse 8 reminds us that Jesus, being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself. The Son of God, being God himself, with all the glory, all the power, all the privileges, all the rights, all the authority, he gave it up. He humbled himself and became what? Obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. Wow. Adam was disobedient. He chose to disobey. Jesus's choice was to be obedient. That's the first point. All right. The second point that we want to look at, the contrast, the opposites here between Adam and Eve, were the consequences of their choices. What did Adam's choice result in? Adam's choice resulted in a debt of sin for all humanity because of one act, one thing of disobedience, eating that fruit from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. That one act of disobedience has resulted in all humanity being charged with sin. Sin is put into everyone's spiritual account from the moment of conception. Now, that doesn't seem fair. It's like, oh, how can all of us be held accountable for Adam's one sin? But actually, it's a blessing, because if it's by one man that sin is charged to our accounts, then it can be by one man that our sin can be forgiven. But just think, if God had to do it all on a case-by-case basis, that would that'd be very difficult for us to understand and to accomplish. But there's two primary ways. This is interesting. There's two primary ways by which sin is charged to every human's account. How sin gets from Adam to us today. And very briefly, because I don't want to spend a lot of time on it, I'm just going to mention it. The first way is called federal headship. Federal headship. And this is the view that Adam is our representative. He was our human representative. He was the representative for all mankind. And so sin is passed to all mankind through Adam as a representative of mankind. Because Adam sinned as a representative of mankind, then we're all sinners. An example of this is also found in the Bible in the book of Joshua, where the Israelites were going up against Ai. But Achan had taken some of the things that were supposed to be dedicated to the Lord. He took them for himself. And as a result, God allowed all the Israelites to suffer the consequences. Achan was a representative, in a way, a federal representative of Israel. Because Achan did what was wrong, then all the Israelites suffered until they took care of it. And so that same way, Adam represents the human race. And because Adam sinned, then we are all sinners. Federal headship. The second way that sin is transmitted is a way that's called natural headship. Natural. And this is the idea that sin is passed physically, naturally, from person to person, beginning with Adam. It's passed down, and we believe that this is done through the fathers, not through the mothers, and that's why Jesus needed to be born of a virgin. He could not have an earthly father, because if he had an earthly father, sin would have been transmitted to him. And we also read that David said, "In sin my mother conceived me," and that he was born in what? Iniquity. All right, now we got these things. Federal headship, natural headship of the way that sin passes down to us from Adam. There's good men, there's smart people that disagree on which one is right. For me, I just say, hey, it's a bit of both. All right, there's no sense arguing about, because you know what? No matter what way you want to go, the outcome is the same. Bottom line here is we're all sinners. We all fall short of God's perfect standard of holiness. We are all charged with a debt of sin as a result of Adam's choice. But what about Jesus' choice? Jesus chose to obey. What did that result in? That results in the crediting of righteousness. Adam's singular act, that one act of disobedience, resulted in a sin debt for all people. But Jesus' obedience, the one act of dying on the cross for our sins, has resulted in the crediting of righteousness in spite of many sins. Just think, that one sin of Adam blew it for everybody, but Jesus's one act covers everybody's sins, multitude of sins, and that is just incredible. And that, of course, it doesn't mean that everybody is saved just because Jesus died for everybody, because there is a response on our part. But it does mean that Jesus' death on the cross is sufficient for all of us. And again, verse 16, I want to read these verses. 16, 18, and 19. You're getting not a very polished show today, but that's not who I am anyway. So it says, "And the gift is not like that which came through the one who sinned, for the judgment which came from the one offense resulted in condemnation. But get this, the free gift which came from many offenses resulted in justification." And then verse 18 says, "Therefore, as through one man's offense, Adam, judgment came to all men, resulting in what? Condemnation. Even so, one man's righteousness, righteous act, the free gift, came to all men, resulting in the justification of life. For as by one man's disobedience, many were made sinners, so also by one man's obedience, many will be, as they put their faith in him, be made righteous." All right? So the consequence of Adam's sin, his choice to sin, is that there's a sin debt that passes down to all of us. But the consequence of Jesus's act, his choice of obedience, is that we can all experience grace and forgiveness and the forgiveness of sin. So the conclusion, this is the third point that I want to contrast. So when we consider the choices, we consider the consequences, but what's the conclusion of this? What's the bottom line? All right, how's it end? One of my favorite movies is The Truman Show. And I just like the movie. I like the story. I'm disappointed with the principal actor and the path that he has chosen for his life. But the movie, the story is excellent. But there's people in the movie and the character, and they wear this little pin on their shirt or wherever, and it says, "How will it end?" And we can ask that question when we consider all this stuff that we're talking about. How will it end? All right, what's the conclusion for each of these potential paths that we could follow? Well, consider Adam. The conclusion of Adam's choice to disobey God that results in a debt of sin, the conclusion is what? Condemnation and death. Verse 18, we read it just a moment ago, says, "As through one man's offense, judgment came to all men, resulting in condemnation." That means a guilty sentence. All right? Verse 18 reminds us that because of sin, we are under condemnation. And we studied this last week. We went through a bunch of scriptures last week that talk about how we're all sinners. And then we went through a bunch of scriptures that say God's wrath is on us. And we saw in those scriptures that God's wrath results in death. All right, in and of ourselves, we are helpless. We're slaves, it says, to sin and death. Verses 14 and 17, it says death reigned. Verse 17, it says, by one man's offense, death reigned. All right, sin is our ruler. Death is our ruler. And we're not exempt. Each person born is a slave to sin, is a slave to death. And that is so, so terrible. No one exempt. All right, all sinners are doomed to condemnation and to death, both physical and spiritual. Though, to me, the spiritual is no doubt the most tragic and the most terrible, because it is separation from God for all eternity. The conclusion of Adam's choice is condemnation and death. But the conclusion of Jesus' choice is justification, all right, being declared innocent, and life. When we put our faith in Jesus and his substitutionary death on the cross for our sins, and when our faith is in Jesus and Jesus alone, all right, without works, which we've already seen in different passages here in the book of Romans, all right, when we do that, when we put our faith in Jesus with apart from works, apart from law, then we receive a not guilty declaration and a guarantee of life. This is incredible. All right, it's wonderful. And the life that we are promised is abundant life. All right, not just here on earth, and even though we experience some trials and tribulations, we still have a wonderful, abundant life full of purpose, but even more so, the life to come. Oh, there's a song. It's an old song. I haven't heard it for years, and I'd probably mess it up if I tried to sing it. Well, I know I'd mess it up if I tried to sing it. But some of you know some of these old songs. You might remember the song, "New Life in Christ, Abundant and Free. What glory shine, what joys are mine. What wonderful blessings I see." I think I messed it up. Some of you will have to email me. I'll give you the email address in a little bit with the right words on that. But new life in Christ, praise God. And we put our faith in Christ because Christ made the choice to obey the Father. He died on the cross for our sins. It results in grace, and the conclusion then is justification in life. Instead of sin and death, grace and life reign in our lives. Praise God for that. Now, I've got two takeaways for us this morning. First of all, let me ask you, what conclusion are you headed towards? How will it end for you? All right? Are you on Adam's path of sin towards condemnation and death? Or have you put your faith in Jesus Christ and you're on his path of grace and justification and life? The life in Christ is a free gift. You receive it by faith. That's emphasized in verse 15. It says, but the free gift is not like the offense. In verse 15 again, it says, in the gift of grace. Verse 16 says, and the gift is not like what came to the one who sinned. And he goes on, but the free gift which came from many offenses. In verse 18, 17 talks about the gift of righteousness. Verse 18, the free gift. All right? Praise God, salvation is free. It's nothing we can work for, nothing we can earn. It's nothing that we deserve by any means. But it's a free gift. You receive it by faith. And so what's your conclusion? All right? Have you received the free gift of salvation in Jesus? I hope you have. And if you haven't, you can. And you just put your faith in Jesus and you pray and say, Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. I know I'm on the path to judgment. I'm on the path to damnation. I'm on the path to condemnation. I'm on the path to hell because of the sin in my life. And it's not just because of Adam's fault, but it's because I've sinned, I've messed up. And you acknowledge that sin and that it's broken the relationship between you and God the Father. But Jesus came, he died for you. He died on the cross to pay the penalty for your sin. So that if you trust in him, he puts his righteousness into your account. And God the Father, when he looks at you, he doesn't see your sin, but he sees the righteousness of Jesus. And he declares you innocent, not based on anything you've done, but it's all about what Jesus has done when he died on the cross and he rose again for you. Have you put your faith in Jesus? Hopefully, you've chosen Christ's path of grace and life. All right? But even if you have, you also, if you've put your faith in Jesus, you have a decision to make today. That word reign is mentioned 5 times in this passage. Reign means to rule. All right? And it's contrasting whether death reigned or whether grace is reigning. And my question right now for us who do know Jesus Christ as Savior, when we think about this word about reign, ruling, let me just ask, who is on the throne of your life? All right? Who's on the throne of your life right now? You might be able to say, yeah, I've trusted in Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior, but are you living for him? All right? Is Jesus on the throne of your life or something else on the throne of your life and reigning in your life today? All right? When we consider that Jesus gave his life for us, he died on the cross, he was obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. Wow. I mean, it should just cause us out of pure gratitude to say, you know what? I'm living for Jesus. He gave his life for me. I want to live for him. And so from here on out, Jesus is on the throne of my life. So who's reigning in your life today, believer? Who's reigning in your life? Those of you who have put your faith in Christ. Yeah, you're going to heaven, but are you living for Jesus? Are you allowing Jesus to be on the throne of your heart to influence the way you talk? To influence the way you act, to influence, to control, actually, not just influence. That's a terrible word, influence, but to reign, to rule the way you talk and the way you act and the way you think. All right? Who's on the throne of your heart today? Is it things of the world? Is it pleasure, power, money, prestige? It can be good things. It can be stuff like family, work, even church ministry. There's so many things that can be on the throne of our lives instead of the Lord Jesus Christ. So I want to challenge us today that when we consider that Jesus gave his life for us, how much more should we give our lives to him? Not just for salvation, but for sanctification and service as well. Let's pray. Father God, just thank you so much for this incredibly condensed, packed passage of scripture that talks about Adam. And it talks about Jesus, and it shows us the contrast between the two. There are two choices, the two consequences, and the two conclusions. And Lord, I pray that you would help each one of us that are listening to this video today, that we would make the right choice ourselves, that we would choose to follow Jesus and not to follow after the way of Adam, that we would choose to give our lives to you. And Lord, knowing so, that as we give our lives to you, that we will receive that free gift of grace, that free gift of salvation that results in justification and a declaration of innocence before God the Father so that we can have a right relationship with him. Father, if there's somebody watching this video that has never put their faith in Jesus, God, I pray that the Holy Spirit, even right now, Lord, as they're watching this video, would soften their hearts and convict them and help them to understand they need to make that choice to follow you even right now, to put their faith in you. And then, Father, help all of us to make sure that Jesus is on the throne of our lives, that he is reigning in our lives, that grace and mercy and kindness and peace and forgiveness and the other things that Jesus gives us are reigning on the throne of our hearts. Lord, help us to follow you. Help us to love you with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Well, I want to thank you for joining me with a video today. Because I'm on the pastor's bus and not at the pastor's porch, pastor's office, pastor's living room, wherever, pastor's basement, I don't have my little note cards. But just a reminder that if you have any questions about what we talked about today, or if you have any prayer requests, anything you'd like to share, if you have the words to that song, New Life in Christ, or something like that, email me, please. My email address is bkschmidt65, bkschmidt, D as in dog, T as in Tom, and then the number 65 at gmail.com. Would love to hear from you. And again, I'm pastor of Calvary Alliance Church. You can find out more about Calvary Alliance Church at calvaryalliancechurch.org. And appreciate Carol keeping up with our website, and it's a neat website. Please go there. And then we are part of the Christian and Missionary Alliance, which is a wonderful denomination. And we were just talking with some folks earlier this week about different denominations, and no denomination is perfect, but I appreciate the CNMA. It's biblically based, and it's Jesus-focused, and it has a passion to reach lost people with the gospel of Christ. And just incredible. And you can find out more about the Christian and Missionary Alliance by going to cmalliance.org, cmalliance.org. And then real quick, things that go on at Calvary Alliance Church. We have our morning worship service Sunday morning at 10:30. As I like to say, nothing fancy, just family. And even last week, the pastor went over. I don't know who that would be, but he went over, and we didn't get out until later. But you know what? People stuck around, and they talked, and they fellowshiped. I mean, for 30 minutes at least. And I just love that about our church. We're family. And so we're not in a rush to get out and get down to the restaurant or home or whatever, but spending time with one another is just awesome. So that's 10:30. Before church on Sunday mornings, I also want to say this. We have our Sunday morning Adult Bible Fellowship, ABF, at 9:15. And Mark and Carol are leading that. And it's a wonderful video series by Ray Vanderland. And he's teaching from on location in places in Palestine and Asia Minor, bringing to us the Word of God in context, and it's just incredible the things that we can learn. So I encourage you to join us 9:15. Monday mornings we have the huddle. We'll not meet tomorrow morning, but next Monday morning at 9 o'clock in the Fellowship Hall. Tuesday morning we have our Tuesday morning ABF at 9:27 in the Fellowship Hall, going through the book of Zechariah. Wednesday night we have prayer meeting at 6 o'clock. Encourage you to come and join with us at prayer meeting. You hear the family that prays together stays together. That's necessarily not true for biological families, but it's also true for church families as well. So please come. If you're a member of Calvary Alliance Church, and if you're not, you're welcome to come and join with us too. All right, please come join with us at Calvary Alliance Church for prayer meeting Wednesdays at 6 o'clock. All right, I think that's it. So thanks for watching this video. I know there's a lot of other videos that you could watch, and podcasts and things like that, but you took time to watch this video. And so from the bottom of my heart, thank you for watching this video. But more importantly, just remember, what choice have you made? All right. What path are you on? Are you on the path of Adam to judgment and destruction and condemnation? Are you on the path of Jesus to righteousness and justification and eternal life? Think about it and pray about it. God bless. We'll talk to you again next week.